This is Ganesh Ranganathan from Integra Global Solutions. And today's guest speaker is Kenny Jain from Pilot. Welcome, Kenny.
Hello, Ganesh. You can give pleasure a
quick,
to be here.
Nice to meet you as well, Kenny. Maybe you can give a quick introduction about what you do in the space and what are all the different activities that you are involved in, and that'll be great for our audience.
Great. Happy to do so. So, yeah. Hi, everyone. My name is Kenny. I am currently working at CFO Services for consumer startups at a firm called Pilot, which provides automated and technology-enabled finance and accounting solutions. So Pilot itself uses technology to really help small businesses scale up their back office. And we take care of everything from bookkeeping to controller services to the financial analysis that comes with it as well. And utilize technology to really scale that up to service a lot of clients at the same time, but at the same time also have a point person that allows for a human touch as well. So on the CFO services end, we take a lot of the data that comes from Pilot and then are able to provide a higher touch for our clients. So I work with about 6 to 8 clients at the same time and provide various levels of services, including financial analysis, strategic planning, some financial modeling as well, and help them with fundraising, thinking about kind of their annual planning and so on and so forth. In terms of my background, I started off my career with a couple of years on Wall Street, then went to a consumer venture capital fund where I was working with similarly a lot of companies at the same time, helping them on very similar things that I do here today. Then a couple of years after, had an opportunity to work in-house at a CPG brand in Los Angeles, where I was working on product development, operations, supply chain, and really got my hands dirty. And so now at Pilot, I'm able to really advise clients from a perspective of not only an investor, but then also a person who's been on the ground floor and actually worked it all. So happy to
be here. Nice. Thank you. Appreciate the background. It looks like you have a lot of different hats that you've worn over the past few years.
Absolutely.
That's great. And in this current realm, you work with different processes with the different companies and clients. So give us some thoughts about how you would identify which one should be taken up for a process and how a company should proceed with even identifying something like that and then proceeding with the process.
Yeah. So, I would say a key component to figuring out what processes need some levels of automation in the first place, I would say come from really having to first map out what workflows are routine and are done on a regular basis, right? So by doing that first, you're able to then see what areas are people maybe having to do a lot of repetitive actions or areas where it's just not worth a person's time to really be focused on that when they have much larger priorities at play, but because no one's doing it, they have to end up doing that. And so when you first start out with that mapping, then you're able to see kind of what areas are repeatable and what areas are able to have an automation that can be put in place. And then from there, you're able to then start brainstorming tools as to what can be used to put there in order to have that person not kind of be a little bit more hands off. And so I think the other aspect too after that is after you look at all the opportunities there are to automate, to then understand what level of investment is required to do so. Is it a software that can be just done on that? Or can you outsource that component to somebody because it requires a little bit more of a discretionary amount of thinking? I think one component, and to highlight that, I think the level of investment may also be dependent upon how much, is it something that can be easily categorized? Is there some level of human element that is needing to be involved? I think we'll determine a lot as to whether or not maybe a software or a outsourced solution might make a lot more sense. Looking at the cost benefit analysis of it, there's time savings relative to kind of the investment put into it, who you're able to help take off and where they're able to put their time. And, I think that requires a little bit of a comparison analysis, but also looking at kind of the mapping out of what you're trying to save there. And then from there, prioritizing what you want to automate first, the amount of time it takes, and the resulting cost savings from that.
So now that you're talking about putting in some technology within the process, what kind of technology would you suggest for different processes? Do you suggest off the shelf or develop on your own, or or use even some automation like macros built in Excel to do some work? What are some of the angles that you have seen that your clients use or you suggest your clients use?
Yeah. So from my perspective, and because I work in the startup realm, so I work with companies that are typically in the pre-seed to Series C realm of the world. So in from that end, I usually suggest that you're kind of building this plane as you're flying it, right? A lot of it does require some level of flexibility, especially during the early stages. You're constantly changing a lot of these assumptions and the structure of your organization. And from that end, I think spreadsheets as a starting point is usually, I would say, the best means to manage all that and provide some level of record tracking and scale and scale and automation. And then you can start adding some really simple processes in place like macros and non-coding related automations that can help take some things off the plate. At the same time, when you do that, it also provides a mapping for your company as to what these processes are. And that in itself can even be used, you know, when you really want to start thinking about automating to a software or to an outsource solution. If you have that on a spreadsheet, at the very least, you have something to start with that you can then present as, you know, what the process looks like now and what you can improve upon there. So usually I recommend starting with a spreadsheet and just having some kind of, you know, a well-established way to organize this information. And then from there, you're able to start exploring, okay, well, what areas of this spreadsheet are becoming too detailed, you know, or where things data is breaking down or, you know, requires too much time on our staff to work on. And usually those questions and in combination with that spreadsheet can be taken to an outsource provider or a software provider, and they are then able to much more accurately diagnose as to what they can do to help with scaling that further.
That's an interesting way of thinking, because especially on this Series A to C companies, they are focused primarily on building whatever they're supposed to build, grow to the next level so that they could get funding, right? And probably accounting and finance is probably an afterthought for them, but still they need to show whatever so that they can get investment from for the next round and so on. So I'm sure, I'm assuming that's where you come into the picture and then help them understand these are all the pieces that needs to be put together and so that they can get their systems and process in place, right?
Exactly. What I tend to notice is that a lot of operators, because they're focused so much on building the business, that these accounting and finance processes are, to your point, like it is an afterthought, and they do have, but they do have processes that they've already been kind of implementing along the way. So most of the time when we start coming in, you see a very, very messy and complex spreadsheet that they've been trying to finagle together. And that's kind of been their software or workflow, so to speak. But at the very least, it at least showcases the way that they're thinking about the business. And it's a starting point to then really redesign or rejigger these components to make something better. But, you know, a lot of the times, especially when it comes to operations, operators tend to work with what they got until it breaks, and then they reevaluate like whether or not they need a solution.
And how would you suggest, so let's say you identify a process, and how would you improve upon it, and how would you measure whether it is the process that you have set is good or not, or whether it is not working, or what needs to be improved? How would you, what's the thought process on how you would do something like that?
Yeah, so I'd say one key aspect is the number of variables that can change within that process. I think the level of flexibility has a big determination as to what kind of solution or design would make sense. I think one of the challenges with taking an off-the-shelf software solution and immediately implementing for a fast-growing startup is sometimes they may add an extra warehouse where they're distributing product, or they're adding another sales channel, of which then the software solution may not have an immediate integration to do that. And so when you factor those what ifs and the amount of change historically that's happened with a system in place, I think that determines a lot as to how much you should automate at that period of time. I think one of the biggest benefits behind spreadsheets, especially early on, is that you can completely redesign everything and have it adjust accordingly. And I think that is, the level of change that has to happen and how much adoption and how much adaption is needed, given how many variables there are, I think is probably the biggest thing to consider when you're trying to look at how automated it can get.
Sure, sure. And you are focused primarily in the CPG, consumer product goods industry, or do you have other types of clients that you work with as well?
I would say personally, my bread and butter has always been in the consumer space, which does involve the CPG world. But that being said, I work with companies across health and wellness, consumer internet, manufacturing as well. So anything, I'd say anything related to physical goods and the movement of them is where my realm is.
Oh, okay. And how do you set up good communication channel in between? I mean, you set up a process. And then how do you set up a communication channel between within the team, outside of the team, and how it should work and so on? How do you normally give advice on that?
Yeah, I think the key part there is really having a SOP logged down, as well as a source of truth that the entire team can lean in on. Mm-hmm. The SOP is definitely probably the key part in logging on, making sure that everything is ticked and tied. I think where communication tends to break down, I would say, is when there are things that are not jotted down, of which someone else, let's say, takes over, and then they don't realize that they're missing a step or two, and then information then starts to become inaccurate and really difficult to process, right? So with the logging SOP, at least you have an area where everyone can follow. If a system breaks, you can then log that, even put a note in there as to what may have changed. And then that way everyone's on the same page as to why they did that, what happened. Mm-hmm. And that usually helps a lot on the communication side of things. The other component is also that source of truth. I think one of the things that I found to be the most helpful is to have a knowledge base area that all team members can really refer to, whether it's through a consolidated document or even notes within a model. But there needs to be, I think, a set of kind of reference points where if something is not totally understood, that the team member can probably look into, let's say, a knowledge depository and immediately get an up-to-date sense as to why are we doing things the way they are.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. I don't want to put you out in there, but do you have an example of a process that you have set up that has gone really well that you could just share an example?
Yeah. So I think one of the things that has been really helpful for a lot of our clients is the setup of a KPI sheet, right? A key performance indicators, things that allow for the entire team to get on the same page as to what is going on, what are the important metrics that we should all be aligned that we should be looking at. So for a CPG company, that may involve looking at sales data, the customer, customer progress on a week by week basis, and also maybe outstanding inventory levels and where are all of these, where are all your SKUs located? And then maybe also a few things, including the marketing metrics. As you can see, there's quite a few disparate information sources that are required to do to kind of consolidate there. And that, I think, is a good example where automation can have a big place in the construction of this because it takes from so many sources. At the same time, you may not have a software that integrates with all that. So I think a combination of software providing some levels of information, but then also having an outsourced solution that can then pull all that together and consolidate it, I think is kind of the best, a world where you can kind of get the best of both. And, a lot of it is routine information. And so, you're able to then, for us, what we can do is map out an SOP as to how to update that accordingly. And if there's information changes or, maybe a different way as to how that information is collected, you can always just change that SOP. And then that way, whoever's updating it is always on the same page as to what kind of metrics are being tracked. And then on the knowledge repository side, being able to help, if there was a central, sometimes we provide a centralized location as to the way some of this information is pulled. A lot of the times the teams will come together and some metrics may seem off. Well, I think a big part of that is dependent on the way this metric is pulled, what exactly we're counting and having the definition behind it. And that's where the knowledge repository is really important, because that way everyone is on the same page as to how certain metrics are being defined.
Yeah, absolutely. So any other points that you want to discuss about process that comes to your mind?
Yeah, I'd say a key part really is that some of these components can get pretty manual. And I think one thing I've noticed is that the more physical some of these processes become, the more it requires an in-person component to be involved. But that also involves, that also creates a world where there's a lot of human error that yes. comes with it as well. And one practice that I've noticed has helped a lot with reducing that human error is really honing in on those human elements and making sure there's a much a comprehensive checkbox that whoever the human element is taking care of is following as well. I think the digital components of it are usually, unless there's a huge amount of human, unless there's a large amount of human judgment involved in discerning that data, a lot of it can, I would say the SOPs can usually handle that pretty well. But then where things really start to break down is really that in-person component and having a lot of checks and balances beyond just prescribing processes, but also having a QC component, I think becomes really becomes pretty critical. And at the same time, understanding that if there is an extensive and exhausting human element process in there, that the more there is within a certain set period of time, the more likely human error is going to pop up because humans really only have so much bandwidth to process at a certain period of time. And the more work that is involved on the human process side, you're just going to have to create more checks in place, whether it's a separate person then checking in on that work, or maybe a kind of data logged way of checking off whether or not something is done is then going to need to be more involved.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So now that you bring about the human process, that humans involved in there, how do you identify the right people to fit in with the process or even the technology? How do you even identify and then put them in place? And even if they look good in paper and all that, once you hire them, you may find them that maybe they're not the right ones. So how do you even identify them before you hire them?
Yeah. So the way that we've tend to find fit in those areas is, I would say case studies and comparable projects are probably your best bet to mm-hmm. understanding whether or not a candidate has that skill set to work around these projects. Mm-hmm. And yeah, to your point, like a lot of people can seem really like a great fit in nature. You know, maybe someone who works, you know, who's looking at a role for a manufacturing processing position has a lot of experience in that as well, but then it doesn't become a fit because maybe the processes that they've learned is totally different than what is being required here. And so the one way to really address that is to have a case study where the case is very similar in problems to what the role is needing and seeing how they, what their thought process is, how they think about it, and outlining kind of, how they tackle the solution. I think that'll probably be the most telling as to whether or not there's a work style fit.
And given then some of the nature, there's that some of the nature of this work is maybe repetitive and might not be too interesting. How do you attract, retain the talent in today's competitive market in this kind of a job? How do you even, certain industry, it might be easier where you may be able to pay more, but in certain other industry, you may not be able to pay that. But what are the other strategies that you can think of?
Yeah, so that is a clear challenge, especially when you have someone who's hired for a very process automated role. You know, eventually over time they do the same thing over and over again, they're not going to feel as motivated, or at the same time they may become less careful because they really don't have sight at the end of the tunnel as to why they're doing what they're doing. And I think part of being able to address that as well as the resulting turnover is, one, giving, you know, there has to be a sense of inclusion in the organization of understanding why we're doing what we're doing, and letting the person who's responsible for that process understand what the larger picture is. And at the same time, also giving them an opportunity to get involved on process improvements. You know, I'm sure a lot of these people tend to have opinions around like why certain things work as they're working through it. And because they're on the ground floor, they actually get to see what they're having, you know, what the automations are working well with and where they have to kind of pick up the slack on. And I think being able to have management have their ear to the ground on even those level of people is important because one, they feel heard, and two, they feel like they can have a real impact on the organization. And, you know, when these people do raise their hands on proposing improvements, make sure that they're not only heard, but then also give them opportunities to explore that further and maybe even have a growth opportunity there. And that would actually motivate them to stay around.
That's a great point you mentioned about having heard. So how do you channel? I mean, let's say you have someone who wants to communicate, and how do you ensure that that communication is reached to the right people and action is taken upon so that you can retain the staff? Or even if not that the intention, if there's some process improvements that they have mentioned or something like that, that it gets acted upon and not get overlooked upon. How do you establish those kind of communication structure?
Yeah. So I think there's a two-way component, one of which is providing a shared communication channel for a lot of this to occur. And, you know, maybe part of it involves, especially if it's a critique on the process, maybe some kind of anonymized way to provide these submissions. And if, you know, it's well heard that the person can have the opportunity to really raise their hand and mention that they were the one to submit it and that they have a means to improve that, you know, as long as there's a, I think one, yeah. So it's one aspect is really being able to have a system that people are able to provide a channel input in, whether it's a Slack channel or somewhat, or an area which there's the entire company is in on. The other aspect is doing regular periodic checks on, or audits really, on the entire system, and to make sure that every step is properly documented, and also, you know, which involves talking with the people who are implementing these processes and asking the right questions on what they're doing and what can be improved. I think, and I think a big part of that is doing periodic checks, you know, either once a quarter or maybe once a month, depending on how quickly things are evolving, I think is particularly important, and just making sure that you're not leaving it on the wayside for it to be ready to break.
Yes, absolutely. And now, I mean, with the COVID, I know people went to a work from home scenario, and then some of them came back to the office full time, and some are still in the hybrid scenario. So with people working in this many different variations of work environment and communication, all that, it's becoming a challenge, right? What do you suggest in managing people with the various kind of work environments they have currently?
Yeah. You know, I think the one area where I've seen a lot of organizations struggle with is, yeah, that uniting of, let's say they have certain parts of staff that are remote and the other parts that are physical. This happens a lot in consumer goods businesses, is that communication tends to break down a lot, right? Because when you're in an in-person organization, a lot of what's communicated tends to not be as structured, or, you know, it's more opportunistic. And so people are able to talk with one another, you know, just by walking by someplace and be able to make improvements from that. Which is great. It has its own benefits. I think one of the challenges with that is that without a structured set of means to do those communications, sometimes that, one, the remote staff may feel disconnected, but at the same time, also it creates a lot of holes as to, you know, maybe certain conversations are now being duplicated, or maybe separate teams are working on the same thing at the same time. And so, in order to unite a lot of that, I think being able to have regular touch points when it comes to the entire organization or the right people, I think on both remote and in-person, helps with making sure everyone's aligned. And at the same time, making sure that the means of communication culturally within the organization take place in a way that allow for everyone to be on the same page, whether it's like a shared Slack channel. You know, I think one of the easiest ways is to have a shared Slack channel where you're really pushing everyone to communicate through that.
Sure.
And, you know, anything that happens in person or offline is then eventually communicated on those shared channels as well. At least keeps everyone on the same page.
Good. Nice. So now that you mentioned usage of some piece of technology like Slack for communication, what other technology have you seen used within the clients that you work with that are useful, not only in terms of communication, but also in terms of the work that they do?
Yeah, I would say a really big component that saves a lot of time is integrations, mm-hmm. and really being able to understand how to make a lot of your tools talk with one another. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of time is really spent, you know, or a lot of time can be overly spent into taking the output of one software and then being able to translate that into another software. Sure. And I think, you know, there is a lot of technologies, including ones like Zapier, that allow for the instant communication between these channels. And mm-hmm. as long as you set up in a way that where they are looking at the same data or consuming the right the same information, then you're able to kind of take your hands off of it. And then you can actually just focus on the output of what those things both work together on.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, just like an app, right? In your mobile phone, apps are probably proliferated. I mean, you look at Android or iPhone, you name it, they have multiple apps for any application, right? Similar to that, even within software, that's starting to happen. So what emerging technologies are you seeing in the workplace that's shaping the way how work is done? What are the new things that you're seeing out in the market?
Yeah. So I mean, clearly AI is a big hot topic right now on on that forefront. And, you know, from what we've seen in terms of how that technology has evolved, there's a lot, it allows for more flexible process automation, which I think is really the big opportunity there, where, you know, before it, you know, data used to be required to be very clear cut for a lot of these systems to communicate with one another. And with AI, because there's a level of more flexibility in terms of the outputs that can come as a result of a more dynamic processing solution, mm-hmm. you're able to have more flexible systems, which is particularly important for areas like inventory management or, mm-hmm. you know, areas like accounting where categorizations of transactions are really important. Mm-hmm. AI is able to then take a lot more context and data to then make more complex judgments around certain processes, which I think is probably one of the most important things. Yes. This is where natural language processing or, you know, the LLMs have a really big role. Mm-hmm. That being said, you still need a human element to review at the end of it, because right now the technology is still limited in the sense that there's a lot of hallucinations or wrong information that it can sometimes confidently put out. But with at least you have a first layer filter that at least allows for the easiest stuff to be automated, but then people are able to really focus in their own attention on the more complex or not straightforward data transfers.
Good suggestion. And how do you even determine now that, I mean, for some people, AI, I mean, a lot of people are not familiar with ChatGPT and how it works, but when it comes to how they're doing their work, how do they even determine what AI or machine learning or NLP technology has to be used and so on? They may be completely new to some of this terminology as well, right? So is that where you come in and then you consult with them and then say, this is what needs to be done and so on?
Yeah, I mean, the reality is the technology has just been so early that, you know, the number of solutions that can be provided are still very much up in the air. And, you know, one thing I recommend a lot of clients do really is to just try it out themselves on, you know, drafting an email or, you know, especially written pieces. I think that's a good area where it allows for people to really brainstorm as to what applications can be possible. Mm-hmm. Copywriting and drafting, you know, papers are usually kind of where it really kind of shows the best of itself. And, you know, at the same time, using it as a area of inspiration, you know, I think it may provide a lot of inaccurate information sometimes, but at the same time, it can also just kind of throw stuff at a wall for you and for you to kind of really have the pick of the litter as to what may be a good idea or a source of inspiration to work off of.
Leaving out of the AI and the machine learning part. So let's say you have a consumer product company or manufacturing company, and they are like an early stage company, they are tracking it in Excel spreadsheet and so on. How do you suggest that, okay, now it's time for you to move away from Excel to do something, use something else more advanced or even more so that it takes less amount of time or something? What stage or what cost trade-off do you say, do you suggest at what point of time do you give an advice on that?
Yeah. So usually software has become more and more critical as you hit a point of scale where mm-hmm. the cost of errors become way more, you know, way more dire, right? So if your team is working on a bunch of spreadsheets and, you know, something ends up breaking that and that can lead to very materially wrong decisions, that end up costing the company, you know, stockouts, or, you know, which can lead to serious, you know, drops in sales. Though usually at those points, when you really start to see that risk balloon quite a bit, is where I think software really needs to then start playing a role, because you need something that doesn't necessarily, that isn't as easy to break, per se. And so, for example, like for inventory management systems, usually when you're at a point of scale where these, you know, your supply chain is humming along pretty aggressively, you're going to need to have data tracking that isn't necessarily as prone to human error, or is reliant upon, you know, data and information that can be easily broken. So usually at that point, you know, when you're really starting to hit a point of scale, or you're required to have a certain cadence of sales that is pretty regular, then usually I start recommending really looking at kind of the a solution out there that would be a good fit, especially if the supply chain has already kind of been more established and you're not running around and changing these systems as much, then usually that's at that point, it's a pretty good fit.
Nice. Okay. And I mean, there's, like you said, there's always a training aspect to the staff, right? When you introduce new software or new process or whatever, how do you train someone when there's a new software that's introduced, so that it doesn't take away from what they're doing, but at the same time, it improves efficiency and so on? What are all the issues that you have seen in the training process, and how do you overcome them?
Yeah, usually it's the implementation and the introductory part, where the, you know, a lot of times these teams are small. And so the idea of having to do the original process and learn a new process in tandem with each other becomes really onerous. And that is where I think the prospect of potentially even being able to outsource that new process becomes really, really beneficial. You could probably hire a professional who is well-versed in that system to then work with someone internally in the company to, you know, potentially even just take that process off their hands, so that way they can focus on other things, and that way they may not even need an additional hire to do so. So, you know, the idea of being able to really combine managed services with technology enablement, I think is really kind of where I've seen the best of both worlds happen.
Nice. What other angles have you seen in the technology front that's interesting that you think that the audience should know about?
Yeah, I would really say the area that I'm really excited for is honestly, the outsourcing space. Yeah, I think given the abilities to, you know, given the way that remote work has really accelerated kind of the development of communication technology, now you're really able to seamlessly communicate with people across the world pretty quickly. And, you know, despite time zones, you know, you're able to still be on the same page when it comes to, you know, whether everyone's on the same messenger, or, you know, video calls right nowadays are, the streaming is usually pretty seamless, right? So that has really allowed for companies to look outside of their locality for talent that is, you know, affordable, but then still essentially just as good. And I think that's kind of where the, you know, I think in this new world now, with how much things are integrated, the idea of a technology-enabled managed services is where, you know, I think this is a world where that really starts to shine.
Completely agree with that. So when we started the company in 2004, outsourcing to smaller firms was an alien concept. So people were thinking, how the hell do you even talk to someone overseas, let alone people from outside of the office, right? But now, especially with the COVID, people have learned that, okay, we can do some of the work. A lot of work can be done remotely. It does now become much easier. They are looking for other companies or other lesser solutions, less expensive solutions like us to do the work. So that's definitely a change that we have seen after COVID for sure. Any other thoughts you have, Ken, on any of these? Any other thoughts that you have for our audience?
No, but and then that's kind of really all I had for the time being, but this has been a fascinating conversation.
Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate it, Ken.